local speaker for tonight. Let me start with a little resume. So he did his PhD in astrophysics in Christ at the Christchurch University of Oxford in 2008, and then had a Henry Skinner Junior Research Fellow at the University of Oxford, about which he told me an interesting story, which I'm not going to repeat. And then had a postdoctoral associate at Yale University, Einstein Fellow at Yale University, and then since 2012 is a professor at the ETH in Zurich. And so he's working on black holes, galaxies, and he's also known for the famous Galaxy Zoom project for public using the public actually to work for us. And they actually gladly do so. Anyway, so I would suggest that we give Kevin a hand and as to welcome him to Heidelberg. Let's know what you can tell us.
All right. Well, great. Thank you very much. Thank you for the wonderful introduction. So what I want to talk to you today about is some ideas about how star formation ends in galaxies. And so the hints on where I'm trying to go with this is that the clues to this may lie in black hole feedback, an idea that sort of waxes and wanes in popularity, and also really in tying the end of star formation in galaxies to the fate of their gas reservoirs, their gas supply. And that's really something that's just on the horizon now with the new radio telescopes that people are building, in particular the SKA precursors. I think they're really going to revolutionize this field. So the big high-level question is, why do some galaxies stop their star formation? There's two broad categories of galaxies. So I took M101. If you look up a disk galaxy, this is what you find in Google. And you find passive galaxies, these large spheroid galaxies that have lost their disk and also stopped their star formation, like M87, which is what you get when you Google elliptical galaxy. And of course, there are lots of ideas, both observationally motivated, on why galaxies stop their star formation. Physics reasons. And so, of course, I already alluded to the idea of AGN feedback, so energy input by growing black holes. The idea that halos, dark matter halos, are ultimately responsible for stopping star formation by starving the galaxies that live in them. When halos reach a certain mass, we believe that it becomes inefficient to accrete gas directly into the galaxies that live in them, and that the gas gets shock heated to a very low temperature, and that makes the cooling of gas in the dark matter halo more difficult. There are also environmental effects of going perhaps closer into the group or cluster structure, that you have this dense intercluster medium, so if you throw in a galaxy, gets stripped of its gas content, and that could slow down or stop its star formation. There are also more modern ideas, like violent disk instabilities, is sort of pushed by a number of groups, in particular by Avishai Deko, or even the idea of morphological quenching, which I think is a very different way of thinking about the problem, where this is proposed by Marie Martek, I think 2 or 3 years ago. The idea that once you establish a bulge in a galaxy, you stabilize the disk against star formation by just increasing the tumor Q just enough so that star formation fades away. So what I'm trying to offer here is just the idea that there are lots of ideas and we can test them. And so my approach in trying to get at this problem is observational. And I use the Zooniverse motto, which is do the simplest thing that works. So this is what our programmers came up with. So these are the people who build Zooniverse projects. Like in this case, I used the logo for the one where you count and analyze penguins. Completely unrelated. But so my approach here is really to say, what are the simplest possible models that we can come up with for galaxy evolution, galaxy collection, that work, broadly speaking? And then think about where do they break down? Like, obviously a simple model is not going to explain everything. And where it breaks down, that's where we learn things. So the picture I'm going to present to you today is very simple. And you know, if you have if you look at an aspect of it and say, no, I know this can't be quite true, I know it works differently, I completely expect that. All I'm trying to do is build a very, very simple picture that then allows us to go that down that line of inquiry. I'm also going to use context a lot as I build my picture of what I think happens in quenching. So what I mean by context is that we now know an awful lot more about the evolution of galaxies, the galaxy population. I'm going to add information about things like stellar ages and space densities and so forth to say, well, it's plausible that this population turns into this one and probably not this one. So I'm going to argue from context a lot. So what are these insights into galaxy evolution that help us simplify the problem and help us give this context to quenching? This is a really profound figure, I think. It's also a terrible figure. So students, when you make figures for your papers, make sure they look really nice on when somebody takes them out of your paper. So this is from a really fascinating paper by Peng et al, where they noticed the following. So what I'm plotting here is galaxy stellar mass on the x-axis and a measure of overdensity. So this is a measure of environment on the y-axis. So going from low-density environments down here all the way to the densest clusters up there. And the colors, the contours, are the fraction of galaxies which are red, which have stopped their star formation. And what the authors of the study noticed is, oh, I can, in a mathematical sense, I can separate two totally independent quenching mechanisms. There's one quenching mechanism that seems to be entirely dependent on the galaxy mass. So there has to be an internal process that tells a galaxy, oh, once I've reached a certain mass, the probability that I should shut off my star formation increases. They call this mass quenching. And there is, again, in a mathematical sense, a completely independent process, which they call environment or satellite quenching, which is, in this projection, completely independent of the galaxy mass. So as you go from low density to high density, the probability that you shut off your star formation of your galaxy goes up. And so these set of contours are completely described by having two independent basis vectors, if you will. So in the space of mass versus environment, or overdensity, or whatever you want to call it, there are two different trajectories you can take, and they're, again, in a mathematical sense, they're independent. And what's interesting, which sort of gives you a clue as to maybe what's operating here, one process, mass quenching, is internal to the galaxy. Nobody cares about the mass of the galaxy itself. And the other one is, almost by definition, related to the large-scale environment of the galaxy. So it has nothing to do with internal processes, at least on the face of it, and everything to do where in cosmic structure you are. Okay? So I'm going to go back and refer a lot to this idea that there must be two different quenching mechanisms, and there may be lead you in the direction of identifying them. Okay? So another really, I think, fascinating insight into the evolution of galaxies is this plot. There's a huge number of papers. I think the original reference, if you want to go back into history, was probably the Brinkman 2004 paper from Sloan. But now lots of other people have made the same observation. And this observation is that if you take the stellar mass, the mass of stars in a galaxy, and the star formation rate, so solar masses per year in a galaxy, if the galaxy is forming stars, they do so in this very well-defined relation. If you know the mass of the galaxy, you know the star formation rate. The spread in this relationship is remarkably small. Now, you may say, well, hold on a minute, this can't be true. I know back in the history of the universe, at high redshift, there was more star formation, and star formation was more intense. This is true, and so now we know that all that happened is that this relation at high redshift moved up. And so I've animated this in a particular way. Note that the point at which you run out of star from the galaxies did not shift. So, in other words, if you plot the mass function, the Schechter function of star-forming galaxies, a function of redshift, as far as we can tell, and people have done this out to Rich, 3 or 4 with fairly good data now, M star of star-forming galaxies, or if you prefer, the point at which galaxies, we no longer have star-forming galaxies on this so-called main sequence, doesn't evolve with redshift. All that happens is the normalization of this main sequence of star formation shifts. Now, not only does this main sequence shift, it has another really neat property, which if I tell you now, you may be skeptical. Go work it out with pen and paper or on a computer. It's really rather neat. Let's take a galaxy at high redshift that's fairly low mass. And so we know its stellar mass, we know its star formation rate. And let's assume it remains a star-forming galaxy until today. So its mass increases because it's star-forming, so the stellar mass increases. And the SFR shifts, but because the main sequence with time shifts too, it turns out that to zeroth order, the absolute star formation rate of this galaxy stays the same. The magnitude of the change is at best a factor of 2 or 3, as long as your galaxy behaves well and stays in the main sequence. So this is the behavior of typical star-forming galaxies, at least after redshifts 2 or 3 or so. So here comes a point where I have to define my terms very carefully. I've used the term already in this talk, and this term is quenching. And it's like downsizing. Everybody has an opinion on what it means, and everybody has a different definition. And I've gotten into intractable arguments with people over the question of quenching, and it turns out 80 or 90% of the disagreement was that we meant something different by the term. So I'm going to define now what I really mean by quenching. So we know they're passive galaxies, so these are galaxies whose star formation rate is significantly lower than the main population of star-forming galaxies. These are the dead galaxies, the red galaxies. Some of these call this the pile of corpses, morbid. But what I mean by quenching is the transition from the state of star formation here to the state of being passive down here. And I can so this is where the disagreement comes in, and where I have to be really careful what I mean. I consider a galaxy, quote unquote, quenched the moment I know that in the future it will move down here. So you could have a galaxy up here whose star formation rate in the near future will drop. If that physical mechanism that causes the galaxy to drop has acted, I consider that galaxy quenched. If you went out and just measured its star formation, you would still call it star forming. So this is a semantic question, but I think it's an important one. And this becomes really important when we talk about, well, how long does it really take to go from being star forming to being quenched? And that's really where sort of the heart of my argument on understanding the physical mechanisms is going to lie. So, this is a galaxy color mass diagram from Sloan, low redshift. This is what's now shown in galaxy evolution kindergarten, because we know it so well. And this is basically a diagram of stellar mass on the x-axis, and U minus R optical color on the y-axis, so you could use a different color, whatever. And we see that the galaxy population has this so-called color bimodality. So we have a blue cloud of star-forming galaxies, this is where predominantly disks live. And we have the so-called red sequence of passively evolving early types. And then we have the space between here, which has been called the Green Valley. And this has been interpreted as the place, as the crossroads of galaxy evolution. So these are the objects which have shut down their star formation, and they're now, because the young stars are no longer being born, the color becomes redder and redder, and the galaxy becomes passive. This was compounded by the fact that I'm now fairly convinced by selection effects, there's a concentration of AGN host galaxies, so galaxies with growing black holes, in this Green Valley. And people sort of declared victory and said, the Green Valley, this is where the quenching galaxies are, and because the AGN live there, it must be AGN feedback that shuts down star formation. And so, take one final look at this diagram. I think this diagram, with its Green Valley in it, is the biggest red herring in galaxy evolution, so I'm going to block it with a fish. What I want you to look at instead is this diagram. This is the galaxy color mass diagram split by morphology. And what you can immediately see is that the color mass diagrams split by morphology look totally different depending on whether you look at just early-type galaxies or just late-type galaxies. In fact, if you look at the LIGHTEC galaxies, there's no bimodality. There's no dip in the Green Valley. In fact, if I hadn't drawn the lines there, it would be almost arbitrary to put them there. The same is true with the early types. There's a whole population which goes all the way down to the bluest colors. And this is this low-mass tail of objects which presumably are in the process of quenching and continuing to populate the right sequence of passively evolving galaxies. But again, where I've placed this so-called Green Valley is pretty much arbitrary on that plot. So I'm going to lay my cards on the table a little bit on where I'm going with all this. I'm going to tie the quenching process to the cosmic supply of gas and the gas reservoirs that galaxies have. So a number of people, there's two leading papers here really. There's one by the group led by Nicolas Boucherdau, another one closer to where I am by Lilly and collaborators. They have described the main sequence, or attempted to explain the main sequence as the idea that what galaxies really are, they're not static objects, but they're flows. So you have gas coming in, you have a gas reservoir, and then you have an outflow, which is feedback from star formation. And what they both posit is the idea that this means galaxies are self-regulated systems, and through a fairly simple analysis, you reach the conclusion that, of course you are on a main sequence, because that's the only state you can have. It's dictated by the inflow of the rate of inflow of cosmological gas. And in fact, you can relate it even further to the assembly of structure by saying it is broadly, though not entirely, related to the specific increase of dark matter halos, so how rapidly a dark matter halo is growing. So, you may believe this or not, all I need to take away from this paradigm is the idea that galaxies have an inflow of gas, they have a gas outflow driven by feedback, and in the galaxy itself there's a gas reservoir. And there's really two ways in which you could disrupt the system. You could turn off the tap. So if I stop the inflow of gas from larger scales, from cosmological scales, the galaxy will eventually shut down its star formation. But it will not do so right away, because you still have a substantial gas reservoir in the extended disk, and perhaps all the way to the halo of gas, that on a reasonable time scale can still cool down and continue to power star formation. So if all you do is stop the inflow of gas from cosmological scales, what you do is you end up with a gas disk that's continued to fuel star formation. So you leave the main sequence and you enter a state where your gas consumption means that your star formation rate declines exponentially. And it does so very slowly for two reasons. One, the dynamical timescales of galaxy gas disks are large. And two, the efficiency of star formation, so the epsilon parameter in the Schmidt law, is small. So if you turn off the tap of a massive galaxy, it will continue forming stars for several gigayears. The characteristic timescale of this exponential decline is about a gigayear, which means star formation will proceed for a long time after the object has actually, this is where my definition is important, has been quenched, right? The gas tap's been turned off. But this is not reflected in observables like star formation rates and so forth for quite a while. Now there's a second way in which you could imagine shutting down star formation in a galaxy like this, and that's you nuke the gas reservoir. Now obviously if you do that, if you have no more gas, you have no more star formation, the galaxy is dead. So the framework I'm going to be operating, so again, this is going back to the very beginning, do the simplest thing that works. So I'm going to model galaxies in the simplest way I could imagine, which is having a constant star formation rate, right, because that's what galaxies do to zeroth order. Then something happens, quenching happens, whatever that is, some physical process happens. And then the galaxy star formation rate enters an exponential, and I let this exponential vary very widely from instantaneous quenching, so the SFR drops to zero, to a very smooth decline over time. And so whenever I show this kind of diagram, the large points here are 1 giga-year time intervals, and the small points are 100 million-year time intervals. So if we go back to our favorite galaxy color mass diagram, I've now removed the effect of dust, which is a bit of a black art, but trust me, it works at redshift zero. At high redshift, I'm not so sure this is a slightly dangerous thing to do, but at redshift zero, we can do it. And now you can see, if you ignore the total galaxy population, you focus instead on just the late types here and just the early types here. What I've just said starts to make more sense. So if you look at the late type galaxies, you have this whole population of star forming things down here. I can tell you this is the main sequence. And then there's this whole tail extending all the way to the red sequence and at high masses. So when late type galaxies, when disks quench, they do so slowly. So this first mode of quenching that I outlined, where all you do is you turn off the tap, what would you expect happens? The galaxies slowly become redder, and you have essentially a traffic jam in the Green Valley. If you have early type galaxies instead, the Green Valley is virtually empty. So if galaxies pass through that Green Valley, and they're early types, so they have transformed their morphologies, they do so very quickly. So that sounds a little bit like that regime where it's not just that you're turning off the tap, it's that you are actually destroying the gas reservoirs. Now there's one wrinkle in all this, which is, of course, if you turn off star formation in a disk, eventually the disk will fade to such a degree that what you're looking at looks like an early type. And you might actually call it an S0 galaxy, a lenticular galaxy. So at some point you probably lose the objects up here because now you call them early types. So one problem, so it follows from the way I set up the discussion about the gas reservoirs that the transition time scales in the Green Valley, whatever that is, for early and late types should look very different. The late types should quench slowly, and the early types should quench rapidly. Now, what you could do very simply is you could take little bins, little cells in mass and color for the galaxy population. You can compute the average or the median specific star formation rate. So how intense is the star formation in those little cells? And it is true, it's actually not obvious, but it's true, that the objects in the Green Valley are actually in the process of quenching. So their star formation rates are already in the process of declining. The problem is, neither here nor there do you have any idea of how rapidly they do so. All I've given you so far is a setup based on circumstance that maybe these things are moving very slowly and these things are moving very rapidly. The only bit of evidence I've produced so far is, well, the Green Valley for late types is pretty crowded, which sounds slow, and the Green Valley for early types pretty empty, which sounds fast. So what I really want to do is measure the rate of change of the specific star formation rate of galaxies in the Green Valley. Now this is hard, and all I'm going to do is constrain this rate of change very, very broadly. But I think it's enough to start to build up a picture where you have these two quenching mechanisms. One slow, one fast. So I'm going to use this diagram to try and constrain these quenching timescales. This is now a color diagram. It's no longer a color mass diagram. And on the horizontal axis here, I'm plotting again this optical color. And on the y-axis, I'm plotting a UV color. So these are near UV observations from galaxies. And what you can see is if you look at the entire galaxy population here, this is the blue cloud, or the main sequence. This is the red sequence, this is the passive galaxies. And we have this population of objects in the middle here. These are the transitioning galaxies. And as shaded in blue and orange here, the early and late type galaxies in the Green Valley. And then I've split it again here, just the early types and just the late types. The key observation in this diagram, and what it really gets you, is the differential colors in the optical and the UV, because that's where the information on time scales is. So, by definition, in the optical Green Valley, both early types and late type galaxies are green yachticles. So their star formation rate, or their specific star formation rate rather, is on the decline. But of the same color, so they have the same amount, roughly, of young to intermediate age stars. This UV color, on the other hand, is sensitive to the youngest star populations. And so you can see that in the Green Valley, the early types are much redder in the UV at the same optical color than the disks. So the early type galaxies have no young stars, they have no OB stars, they have nothing that produces a lot of UV. Whereas the disks, they still do. So, sounds like disks are quenching slowly, and early type galaxies are quenching rapidly. Let's be a bit more quantitative and go back to the setup that I presented earlier, where we can let a galaxy quench very rapidly or very slowly. So watch the red dot. I've put it on both these diagrams here at the starting point, so down here and up there, and I'm going to do two things. I'm going to quench a galaxy very rapidly, following this model, and I'm going to quench a galaxy very, very slowly. So first, let's quench a galaxy very, very rapidly. Let me show you that one more time. So within about a giga-year, if you simply shut off star formation instantaneously, if you simply let the galaxy go, within a giga-year, it will transition from blue to red. You'll do so very rapidly. Remember these small points here, 100 million year time intervals. And you go straight through the locus on this UV color, UV optical color diagram, where the early types live. On the other hand, you completely avoid the place where most of the disk galaxies that are in the process of quenching, where they live. So let me now show you the opposite. Let me now quench a galaxy very, very slowly and see what happens. So this galaxy also is a few giga years later, has essentially ceased star formation. But no, because it is doing so slowly, 4.5 giga years later, it has barely left the blue cloud. It has barely entered the Green Valley. So this is another way in which the Green Valley actually is a giant red herring, a giant distraction. By the time a galaxy is in the Green Valley, a significant amount of time has elapsed. The minimum amount of time is illustrated with this fast quenching track here. By the time you're sort of in the middle of the Green Valley, several hundred million years have elapsed. If you're quenching slowly, like a disk galaxy here, many giga years could have elapsed. So whatever physical process it was that did the quenching has already happened. So by studying galaxies in the Green Valley, we are challenged and we're probably unlikely to figure out what it is that did the deed. Now another thing that's becoming increasingly clear here is that if you look at the early types, they're consistent with essentially shutting down their star formation instantaneously or in a time scale of 100 to 200 million years. That sounds pretty dramatic. That sounds inconsistent with this just turning off the tap. This sounds like something a forcing mechanism, a pretty powerful forcing mechanism should have triggered this rapid quenching of star formation. In fact, if you look at early type galaxies, elliptical galaxies in the blue cloud in the Green Valley, if you look at them in deeper imaging, we find that many of them, a very high fraction, have strong indications of recent mergers, recent interactions, recent mergers. One goes so far to say that it's any major mergers. But the working hypothesis here is that these new blue ellipticals that appear blue and then rapidly move to the red sequence, that they are recent merger products. That's one way, one mechanism that at least makes it plausible why they shut down the star formation so rapidly. This also points in the direction, thinking back to the Ping et al. Separability of environment and mass quenching, This makes it an internal process. This rapid quenching in early types seems like an internally driven process. Whereas, as I'm now about to show you, the slow quenching that the disks undergo, well, maybe you could imagine that being influenced by the environment. And so this is where I'm going next. What about the environment? Doing environment is hard because everybody defines it differently. All I'm doing here is pretty much the simplest thing I could imagine to check what the environment is doing. And so top, I'm again plotting just the early type galaxies on the colonized diagram and just the late type galaxies down here. And the left column is in a dark matter halo mass catalog. This comes from abundance matching, which again is a bit of a dark art. I've split by halo mass around 10 to the 12th. Why did I pick 10 to the 12th? That's the sort of magic halo mass where we think the transition of cold to hot accretion in dark matter halos happens. And, you know, to me it was pretty striking. If you look at blue and green galaxies amongst early types, they seem to be present both in low and high mass halos. So again, whatever happens in these early types seems to be a process that at least primarily is not driven by environment, that is primarily a process that's internally driven. If I ever look at the late types, if we go to low mass halos, essentially the entire late type population is blue and star forming. And if we go into a high mass halo, once we're above 10 to the 12 solar masses, almost all the late types are quenched. And in fact, have been quenched for a while. You have a bit of a tail here, and most of the objects are up here. So if you think back to, you know, how long does it take to enter even the Green Valley based on that slow quenching simulation? So these gases have been dead for giga years. Now, thinking of these massive, slowly quenching disks, there are two famous disk galaxies that may actually help us understand this a little bit better. So this is, again, a color mass diagram. This is from a paper by Darren Troughton's group in Swinburne, led by Simon Mutch. And they tried as best as they could work out the mass and color of the Milky Way and M31. It turns out working out the color of the Milky Way is hard. Working out the star formation rate of the Milky Way is hard. As best as we can tell, the Milky Way is maybe just still consistent with being an ordinary star-forming galaxy on the main sequence, you know, that tight relation between mass and star formation rate. But M31, we're pretty sure the star formation rate today is too low to place it on the main sequence. And if you look at the color of M31, which is again, it's actually quite hard to measure, but has been measured, it's in the Green Valley. So certainly M31, perhaps even the Milky Way, have already quenched. So I refer to them as the zombie galaxies. They're still moving, they're still going, but they're already dead, they just don't know it yet. Okay, so what about the AGN? I think, you know, for me at least, when I did all this work, this is sort of the question at the back of my mind. Well, do the AGN have anything to do with anything? Okay, so here is back this slightly busy, but I think incredibly instructive UV optical color diagram. And the green points I'm plotting here are type 2 emission line selected Seaford AGN. And they're in the Green Valley. This is what has been known for a long time, and the majority of them are actually in disks, as the X-ray astronomers have known this for 25 years or more. It's now coming back that no local AGN are not in bulge-dominated galaxies. I think Sloan has led us a little bit astray. That's a whole story I can tell you over a beer. But the AGN are in the Green Valley. And so again, you can see how the Green Valley is actually a giant distraction. If the AGN are, this basically proves that these AGN, at least, cannot possibly be responsible for the shutdown of star formation. Why? Look at the tracks. The quenching happened down here. By the time you reach the point in the color space where we see the AGN, the quenching has happened. In the case of the early types, hundreds of mega years ago, in the case of the LaTeX, giga years ago. So these AGN are not responsible for the shutdown of star formation. Does that mean the AGN are completely out of the picture? I don't think so. For starters, these are emission line selected AGN, and of course, star formation also produces emission lines, which means AGN are harder to find than star forming galaxies. So, if we want to find the AGN that are responsible for quenching, if they indeed are, we need to find AGN in star forming galaxies that we know in the future will quench. So it's a bit like a pre-crime or a fortune teller. We have to figure out the galaxies which will die in the near future and see, do they contain AGN and what are the AGN doing? If that sounds like a bit of a challenge, it is. But I think it's the only way we can approach this problem, because these AGN, which we've been studying for a long time, they cannot possibly be relevant to the question of quenching. So let me now proceed and go back to the gas. So I'm going to show you what I think is a really intriguing result from ultra-deep H1 observations, tracking the fate of gas in these quenching galaxies. And so what I'm going to show you is results from observations of four galaxies. And if you're not convinced by a beautiful story that works based on four galaxies, you know, I'm with you. I want 400,000, and very soon the ASCAP precursors in Australia and South Africa will give that to us. So, again, four galaxies, each galaxy observed for 24 hours with Vesterborg. So, we're not going to do 400,000 with Vesterborg, we're going to have to wait for these new facilities. So, galaxy color mass diagram, and we selected four Green Valley early type galaxies. So these are early type galaxies which very recently were intensely star forming and are now in the process of shutting down their star formation and becoming members of the Red and Dead Red Sequence Club. Here are their images, Sloan images. And moving on, here are is the UV optical color diagram, again with the quenching tracks here. And what's nice is those four galaxies, they're pretty much the same optical color, but they span a wide range in UV color. So we have one down here, J1237, this one over here, which is still has a lot of UV emission, so the star formation is still kind of there. And then going along the sequence this way, or rather going this direction, the UV fades away more rapidly. And so this is to zeroth order of time axis. So context, we have galaxies which were very recently star forming and are now in the process of shutting down, and they did so rapidly. So again, because of their position in this UV color diagram, we know their star formation shut down rapidly, so they can't be in this mode where all that happened is you turn off the gas tap. They're quenching rapidly, something must have happened to their gas reservoir, and we wanted to find out what it is. So galaxy number one, in white, are the H1 contours, and in green we have the associated gradient continuum. So this galaxy still has a gas reservoir. It is smaller than would be needed to sustain star formation on the main sequence, but it still has a gas reservoir. And we think the radial continuum that we see here is also emission from star formation. Taking a step forward in time, no more radial continuum. But, oh, what's that? The remaining H1 reservoir is slightly displaced from the galaxy. Now, this is not unusual. Lots of galaxies have slightly displaced or skewed gas reservoirs, in particular when they're in the process of falling into a group or cluster. Now, we checked, and this galaxy is not falling into a group or cluster. But for whatever reason, its H1 reservoir is offset from the galaxy. Okay, interesting. Let's step forward in time, go to the next one. The entire gas reservoir, the entire remaining gas reservoir, is displaced from the galaxy. Okay, again, back context. Very recently, a few 200-300 million years ago, this galaxy was star forming. Now it is not, and we find whatever gas remains in the system expelled. This is the final one. When we saw the data, I almost didn't believe it because it lines up just too nicely. So you shouldn't believe it either. Believe me when I come back with thousands of galaxies. This is the final one. The entire H1 reservoir ejected from the galaxy at many tens of kiloparsecs, and these, we are fairly certain, are relic radio lobes from a radio jet that was active in the recent past. So I like that because it is consistent with my picture where some process destroys gas reservoirs in rapidly quenching early type galaxies, and the prime candidate, perhaps, being the AGN, except of course these are radio jets, which tells you it probably wasn't those optically bright, classic Seyfert quasar type AGN. So this is where I want to transition to now, this idea that if we want to tackle this AGN feedback problem, I think we have to rethink quite a few things. And we essentially have to enter a kind of time domain AGN physics, AGN observation. And when I say time domain, I don't mean variability on human timescales, but I mean variability on longer timescales. And precisely what timescales I mean, I'll get to in a moment. So this is a beautiful outline of what accretion disks look like and what they do as a function of Eddington ratio. So if you increase the Eddington ratio, you increase the fueling of the black hole, you increase the accretion rate, you change the way the system appears. And in particular, if the system is high Eddington, if it is rapidly accreting, it is dominated by radiative processes, meaning photons, which we can see, which then manifest themselves as quasar light, accretion disk light, as photoionization in the galaxy, and so forth. When the accretion rate drops, when the Eddington ratio drops, the system, we think, transitions to a state where more and more of the energy comes out as mechanical energy, whether it be as jets, winds, outflows, disk winds, whatever it be, aka in ways that are much harder to see. Now, we know from stellar mass black holes, from X-ray binaries, that the same X-ray binary on timescales of hours, days, weeks can go through a whole range of states. So this is just one example. This is actually a cartoon. We can do this with real data for individual X-ray binaries, where the whole accretion state system will cycle through these different states on timescales of days or weeks or whatever it be, and so the appearance of the system totally changes, and what it does to its surroundings totally changes. And so people have proposed the idea, well, what if AGN did the same thing? Well, would we know? Well, probably not, because instead of days or weeks, this would take hundreds of thousands or millions of years. Now, the problem with doing this analogy, and I put it here in scare quotes, because I don't think it's quite an analogy. It's not that you can just, you know, multiply by the black hole mass and get the relevant numbers for AGN. It's more complicated than that. For starters, this is the X-ray intensity or luminosity, if you want, an X-ray hardness for these stellar mass black holes. The problem is, if you take your Shakura Sunyaev disk and you ask, you know, what part of the CD am I looking at here for a 10 solar mass black hole or a 10 to the 8 solar mass black hole? Of course, the answer is different because the temperature changes. So what's called X-rays here in the X-ray binaries for quasars is the UV, which we, for the most part, can't observe. So that's already a challenge. Another challenge is, of course, that the instabilities in the accretion disk that cause this kind of behavior in the case of AGN and X-ray binaries probably is very different. X-ray binaries, by their nature, are much more constrained systems because the flow of material, the mass transfer from the donor star, is a much more regulated system. So what comes from the donor star is much more constrained. In the case of an AGN in a galactic center, it's probably far, far more chaotic because it depends on what lump of gas at this point managed to lose the last bit of angular momentum to fall in. So the cause of the instabilities that make maybe AGN flip around with this kind of diagram on 100,000 year time scales is probably far more crazy and chaotic than it is in case of X-ray binaries. Now, why do I find this analogy so interesting? We know that some X-ray binaries do really interesting things when they're not optically bright, when they don't produce a lot of photons, but when they're optically dull, so when they go down in Eddington ratio. This is from a really cool Nature paper by Paco et al. This is a ULX, a really luminous X-ray binary in a nearby galaxy. So here you can see the X-ray binary. And it's excavating a 300 parsec bubble in this galaxy. So this tiny little black hole is punching a giant cavity into that galaxy. You can barely see it in optical light. And in fact, if you do sort of a PDD type of argument, like how much kinetic energy is this thing injecting into its host galaxy versus how many photons do we receive from this system? The ratio is about 1,000 to 1. So my question is, what if AGN do the same thing? How would we even know? Because the only things we've been studying, for the most part, are bright quasars, i.e. the state in which the AGN produces a lot of photons. So the first clue that sort of set me on this journey was this object. I'm going to butcher the name. It's discovered by a Dutch school teacher named Hanny van Arkel. She was a citizen scientist taking part in the Galaxy Zoo. And she said, well, hold on a minute, what is this thing? So this is now the Hubble image, is much nicer. It's a giant narrow line neutrino, a giant quasar photoionized cloud next to this galaxy at a redshift of 0.05. And it was named after her, Hanny's object, and then very quickly, Hanny's Farvek. Did I say that right?
Yeah.
Roughly. Hanny's object, or Hanny's thingy. And it's a giant quasar photoionized nebula. If you calculate the minimum bolometric luminosity to light up this cloud, it's at least 10 to the 46, probably a lot more. So this is the brightest quasar near us. And as far as we can tell, with every available telescope that we've been able to train on this galaxy, the AGN there is at least 2 orders of magnitude, if not 4 orders of magnitude fainter needed to ionize this cloud. So we think what happened here is that the quasar was on just 200,000 years ago, which is roughly the light travel time from the center of the galaxy to here, the quasar shut off. We still see this light occur. So maybe quasars, at least in one case, go through these crazy state changes as the energy ratio goes up and down. And in fact, as we start to study the center of this galaxy, we see a very small scale radio jet that has just been launched. We see a bubble of ionized gas. We're currently evaluating whether there's a bubble in the hot X-ray gas in this galaxy. It's getting intriguing. So maybe quasars do the same kind of cycling. And maybe it is the low state, or the optically dull state, the kinetically bright state, that's really important for transforming galaxies and throwing out the gas reservoirs. Now, the cool thing about working with citizen scientists is that you go, well, we found this like bluish-purple splotchy thing next to a galaxy. Are there any others? Can you go check? They go do check, then we take Hubble images of them, and we find objects like these. So in green here, again, is the O3 emission line. So this is where the AGN is photoionized the system. And in the case of these galaxies, the center, the nucleus, is not bright enough to account for the luminosity that you had 50 to 100,000 years ago in the system. So clearly this kind of behavior is perhaps not isolated to one object, perhaps it is common to all AGN. And what we really see here is crazy structures that we cannot explain. Why is there a galaxy scale bubble here, or ring, or whatever it is? Why do you have almost like a double helix structure here? We don't really understand this yet, but we're making progress as we analyze these systems. So what these things tell us is, oh, you have an AGN, it creates this giant ionization nebula, it shuts off, you're left with a nebula. That's interesting. So this is really sort of going to really current work, the things that we're thinking about right now. Well, is there an analog to the state during the switch-on phase, right? How would you know if an AGN just switched on? And so we just submitted a paper where we make the following argument. We think there are such a thing as inverse Forvaps. So, and they've been known in the literature, they've been known in surveys for a long time, they're called by the glorious acronym of X-BOMs, or X-ray bright optically normal galaxies. And so what you have is galaxies, AGN and AGN surveys, a few percent of them, you see X-rays from the center, but if you look at the galaxy, you see no large-scale photoionization. And there are always a few percent of each AGM survey, it doesn't matter how you do it. And so my take on this is that these are actually the objects which have just switched on, but they've not yet generated extended photoionized emission like you saw in the case of the fallouts. And the duration of this phase must be on the order of 10 to the 4 years, which is the scale of the large-scale narrow line region, which we know from measurements. It's also roughly the scale of, you know, where's the gas in the galaxy, what's your screen that you're looking at. So once the AGN has been on for a while, it's going to generate a galaxy-scale narrow line region, probably in the shape of an ionization cone. And then we call it a normal AGN. We have X-rays from the center, we have the photoionization, normal AGN, great. Now, when the AGN switches off, right, we still have the light echo. This is the fallout phase. One of the cool things is, I just told you it takes 10 to 4 years or so to photoionize the galaxy, and a few percent of AGN are in this switch-on state. That means that you can immediately divide the two and conclude that this phase, the normal on phase, is just 10 to the 5 years. So the typical duration of an AGN phase is just 10 to the 5 years, which means to build massive black holes, you need many, many, many of these short flickering cycles, which means that, yeah, maybe AGN do flicker and switch state rapidly the way X-ray binaries do, which again opens the door to the idea that maybe it's not this X-ray bright, optically bright phase that does the interesting work. Maybe it's the optically dull phase, either during the switch on or the switch off or in between, where interesting things happen. So to sort of cap it off, this is one of those crazy things with this many kiloparsec scale structure here. We've done a spectroscopic study led by Nyami et al. And this just came out, where we've calculated the luminosity as a function of distance, you know, across the system, and we see that in the last, you know, few tens of thousands of years, the luminosity dropped by at least an order of magnitude, and this is with really poor ground-based resolution. We hope to redo this soon with higher resolution data. At the same time, the Durham group got high resolution radio observations of this source, noting that there's an AGN source at the center, there's an extension here in this direction, and then you have this loop here where you have, and you see the effects of the impact between the jet and the gas happening right now. So, again, evidence that the AGN shut down the luminosity, launched a radio jet, started doing something else that's interesting, perhaps at the same time blowing this giant bubble. So, I see I'm running out of time, so I'm going to skip my narrative version of galaxy evolution. So this is a set of cartoons I made for the evolution of early types. It sort of encapsulates my picture of what happens to the gas in the case of early and late types. If you want to see it, come see me later. But so the idea is ultimately, most galaxy quenching probably has nothing to do with AGN, except that it happens rapidly. And I'm trying to motivate the idea that this rapid flickering we see between different accretion states, which is increasing evidence for in local AGN, that maybe that's the way that it's done. So let me put up my summary slide and end here. Thank you very much. If it's still in the blue cloud, you mean?
I mean, if it's in the blue cloud, yeah, but you shot this part.
Yes.
Well, you were starting at a specific point.
So your question is, I see. So, yes. So the quantitative arguments I make are really broad. Like, constraining actual timescales for individual galaxies, I don't claim we can do. Maybe you can. But you probably need a lot better observations, maybe spectroscopic observations, to say anything stronger than short and long. Maybe it can be done, but certainly we didn't do that here.
So when you, it's very very basic, just for interest. So when you show this plot and you separate late and early type galaxies, I mean, you took the color as a proxy for star formation rate, the y-axis. So what was the criteria to separate galaxies in early and late type? So it wasn't star formation rate there, apparently.
How do we divide galaxies into early and late? By shape, by looking at them, by getting, 400,000 people across the internet to vote on galaxies.
So, but if, let's say, lenticulars, which you count as early type, so they are still, they should have similar shape except for their knotty structure. Yeah? So that's the difference here. It's not kinematic.
So where exactly the lenticulars fit into all this is a really fascinating question and one we're debating right now. If you think of a massive disk galaxy and you slowly turn down the star formation, the disk will slowly, slowly fade. You'll eventually lose the spiral structure. And so there comes a point at which it moves probably from the late type bin into the early type bin. When exactly that happens is probably hard to determine. But I do think like the reason we don't see a true red sequence in the late types is because eventually precisely that happens and they get put into the early type bin. Yes. Sounds like it's still on the main sequence, and so in Zurich we like to debate this question a lot, and it always ends up with, well, in terms of the measurements that we get from the literature, it's just at the edge of the main sequence, and so the people who say it's not quench stable, obviously it's still on it, the people who want it to be quench stable, well, it's just on the edge of it, but I don't think we can really tell one way or the other. So in the arguments about extended narrow line regions, that includes type 1s. I mean, type 1s also generate a narrow line region. For the discussion of the galaxy evolution aspect, of course we stick to the type 2s because then we don't have to worry about AGN contamination of the optical colors. And we essentially assume that the type 1s must behave the same way by asserting that unification is true. Is that a justified thing to do? Well, probably, but it's probably also worth going back and really looking at that more carefully.
Just a quick follow-up on the early versus late type question before. You've already explained that when the disk fades and the specific star formation rate drops, then probably the galaxy goes from the late type to the early type in. But if we forget about the traditional classification and just look at the parameter space, does it mean that there is basically a continuum in terms of, let's call it the Green Valley transition time? Or is there still like two density peaks, etc.?
So we just had a PhD student at Oxford look into that question. And it does look like with the available data, there is a continuum. But I'm not convinced myself yet either way whether this is truly what the universe is telling us or whether this is the limit of our resolution if we just basically take one of our colors and fit simple models to them.
Correctly, you argue that the AGN might be on only for about 10 to 12 years, which is awfully short.
Yes.
But
only way you can combine those two things, and at some level they have to combine because we know black hole growth takes 10 to the 7 to 10 to the 9 years, is that at any one time you must have many of these short phases following each other. So to have what would we call a single AGN phase sort of from a cosmological view is actually made up of lots of tiny little accretion phases during which the AGN switches back between the states. That's sort of the picture I had in mind for how you combine those two statements.
So why do we even try to find so fervently a source for massive accretion, for most of the black hole mass? What's the argument against assuming that they are born at very early times at quite substantial mass already? So why do we worry about there possibly being short and maybe not so frequent accretion events, gas accretion events, in cosmic history?
So you're thinking of the high redshift quasars, like, but how do we have a billion solar mass black hole at redshift 7.1?
Well, even if I didn't know about them, I wouldn't know that they wouldn't be there either, so.
It's a tricky question. We worry a lot about these very massive black holes at high redshift. Observationally at the moment, we try new things like try and measure their spin and figure out what realistic growth scenarios for them are allowed, which ones are ruled out. I've not thought deeply about what the short flickering time scale would imply for higher redshift growth. But then you really run into the problem of, are you talking about regular black hole Eddington limited ultimately black hole accretion, or are you thinking about the more exotic growth mechanisms that people have proposed, where you essentially force feed black holes or grow them at super Eddington speeds, or you embed them into giant protostars or quasi stars or whatever? I haven't thought about that. That's a whole separate question. So yeah, we thought about that for a long time. I think ultimately the problem is we only have four galaxies and we'd like many more to see is this generally true. So there's several things at play here. So one, the gas that's expelled can't be the entire gas reservoir. It's basically the leftovers, and they have to be expelled because otherwise star formation would restart. One way in which you could have generated this asymmetry is if you believe these are late stage mergers, then maybe the gas reservoir isn't in any sort of equilibrium anyway. And so if you have a feedback phase that is not particularly directional, you just have ultimately a preferred direction for most of the reservoir. That would be an explanation, but I think that has to be tested once we have more of this H1 data.